All right, everybody, welcome back to Open Forum. Open Forum is where we just talk about what's on you guys' heart and answer each other questions and give each other godly counsel. So what I want to do today in this Open Forum is to start off with just talking a little bit about, you know, my ministry and some of the reconstructions that I'm doing with my ministry. So as you guys know, that this was the year for new things, new callings, just new endeavors that God's placed in our heart. And for me, what this year has looked like, it looks like I was dismantling everything I've ever done and kind of putting all the pieces on the table and then trying to reconfigure what comes back and what stays broken. Right. And so early this year, I was like, hey guys, we're going to stop doing the daily podcast. But I got a couple emails from people saying, hey, I really love the daily podcast. Even though you get all the content in the online forum, I mean, in the community, I actually like the podcast every day. You know, and I said, well, we just go and just listen to whatever you want to listen to. You don't have to worry about the podcast. But I got a good overwhelming feedback, almost 100%, that people wanted the podcast coming back. And so with that said, you know, I was praying about it because I felt like God was moving away from the podcast. But, you know, with everybody saying they want the podcast, I was praying about it. And the expression I put it, it seemed good with the Holy Spirit to bring it back. Right. So it wasn't like it was like a dust says, Lord, you got to bring it back. But it seemed good that we bring it back. And as I was praying about what this looked like to bring it back, what God reminded me of was that in 2014, when he called me into ministry, he actually started with a podcast. And the name of the podcast was Church for Entrepreneurs. So in 2014, the podcast was called Church for Entrepreneurs. All of Church for Entrepreneurs was really just that daily podcast. And it was just that daily podcast that was designed to actually grow up entrepreneurs in their faith so they can have the faith and the foundation they need to actually do the things that God's called them to do. Because when God was talking to me about entrepreneurs in 2014, he was like, it's not really the tools and tactics of business that's going to make them successful. It's going to be their faith to make them successful. Because the difference between us as Christian entrepreneurs and secular entrepreneurs is that we are leaning on the Holy Spirit to guide us in what we do. We're not just chasing trends. We're not just chasing money, right? Because if we were just chasing trends and money, we could just listen to the world and we could just follow the world system. But what we're saying is different about us is that we believe God has spoken to our spirit to build something, to do something. And when God speaks something to you, you know, the Bible says that we can't even imagine the things that God has for us, right? We haven't even seen, our ears haven't even heard what God has in store for them that love him, right? So when God speaks an entrepreneurial word to your spirit, it's designed to be more wonderful than you can even imagine or think, right? And so in order to tap into that wonderfulness of God, it's really going to be your faith that does that. Right. It's not going to be listening to a business book. It's not going to be calling up Gary Vee. It's not going to be any of that. Right. You really got to tap into the Holy Spirit because he is the one who sees further than we can see. Right. And so the goal of the podcast was to kind of give you guys the faith that you needed to start to see what God sees. You know, the Bible tells us that we need to renew our mind so we can prove what the will of God is for our life. And the way we renew our mind is with his word, right? And so here's how it works. So imagine the Holy Spirit's on a particular wavelength. He's talking to us all the time because he's in our spirit. And then the only way we can hear the Holy Spirit is that our mind has to connect with the Holy Spirit, or the Bible calls the mind the soul, right? So your soul slash your mind has to connect with the Holy Spirit to hear what the Holy Spirit's saying. However, if your mind realm is full of worldly information, it's out of frequency. So the Holy Spirit is talking, but your mind is on the wrong frequency to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying, right? And so, but when you train your mind with the word of God, that's why we call it a podcast like word training. The more you train your mind with the word of God, it aligns you to the Holy Spirit and you get to hear what the Holy Spirit is saying to you. So that's why you can be, you can be studying on marriage, and because your mind has been renewed to marriage, it can tap into the Holy Spirit to hear something about business, right? You can be studying about holiness and it will align your mind to hear something about business. So anything you study from the Word of God aligns you with God's wavelength, and that alignment, his wavelength, calls you to hear the Holy Spirit. So that's why when you notice when I teach the Word, it's not just about business. It's about the whole counsel of God, because every time you learn another side of God, it aligns you with God so you can hear him for what he's, what she's calling you to do, right? So with that said, it seemed good to the Holy Spirit to bring back the podcast, because you guys told me you want the podcast back, right? One of my old pastors, my previous pastor, he said one thing about ministry. He told me when I was leaving to start my own church, he said, what you're going to find, Amos, is that ministry is no longer for you. It's for everybody else, right? It's who you're serving, right? So for me, you know, I don't really need the podcast anymore. I can just go listen to anything I want to listen to. But for the people I'm serving, they needed the podcast, right? So I had to remind myself, okay, this is not about me. I got to listen to the people that I'm called to lead, I'm called to serve. So if they're telling me, hey, Amos, we need this thing, why am I not doing it, right? So that was kind of a reminder for me. It's like ministry is for the people, not for me. And so with that said, the next thing the Holy Spirit told me to do was, he was like, okay, let's call the podcast Church for Entrepreneurs again, right? Let's go back to 2014 and let's call this thing Church for Entrepreneurs, right? And so starting today, the podcast Church for Entrepreneurs is once again a 10-minute daily podcast, 7 days a week. So every morning, 7 days a week, you can listen to it 10 minutes in the morning, and that can begin to rewrite your mind with God's word so you can hear what God is speaking to your spirit about what he called you to do, right? Now, with doing that, that opens up a whole can of worms about focus, right? Because I told you guys about focus, right? If I got one axe and I'm swinging that one axe at 20 trees, you know, it's going to take a long time for things to fall, right? Because so I'm doing Church for Entrepreneurs, I'm doing Faith Leaders, I'm doing Atlanta. So it's like, I'm the only one axe here. And so I'm swinging at several different things, right? So that creates a paradox that I have to work through, right? Because ideally, one man, one focus, right? And so what God was showing me was that, yeah, one man, one focus, but I could be multiple men, right? So which means that it's time for me to start thinking more infrastructure, right? So it's like when Facebook bought Instagram, they didn't stop Instagram because they already had Facebook. Or when they bought Oculus, they didn't stop Oculus, right? So it's like they just built the infrastructure to handle the different things that they were wanting to get into, right? And so what God speaking to my spirit in this year of new is like, Amos, you need to build some new infrastructures now, right? Because you can't just stop stuff every time I tell you to do something different, right? And so in this year of new, one of my goals is to figure out, how do I build an infrastructure that I can actually do the different things that God's placed in my heart without always breaking my focus? And so the first phase of that, he had me to go and streamline and categorize all the things I was doing and give each thing I was doing a unique focus, right? So how's that look? So I start with me as the center. So what's my calling? My calling is to help believers discover the thing that God's called them to do and help them do that thing through the Word of God. That's my foundational calling, right? And kind of everything I do is kind of flows through that foundational calling, right? So the first category of the false purpose point is Church for Entrepreneurs. Church for Entrepreneurs is a daily podcast, 10 minutes long, designed to grow your faith so you can renew your mind to the Word of God, so you can hear what God's called to do. That's the focus of Church for Entrepreneurs. And what God told me is that I got to be content disciplined, which means on the podcast, it need to be just the daily word, right? It can't be all this other stuff I used to put on the podcast, right? So he wants me disciplined in my content. So when I'm posting on the podcast, it's not my thoughts. It's not my personal blog. I need to be content disciplined and produce the daily word, right? So be content disciplined. So that's the first focus point. The second focus point is what is faith leaders. I have a calling to train ministers to develop their unique form and style of ministry, right? That's very different than Church for Entrepreneurs, but it still flows out of my focus of helping believers discover their calling and implement it. In this case, is the demographic is ministers, right? Ministers who have a calling to start things that may be different than normal, right? They're not necessarily planning a traditional church. They may have an online ministry. They may have all kinds of different kinds of ministry. And Faith Leaders is designed to give people the theological framework to understand how to study the word, how to teach the word, how to develop their ministry, right? How to handle objections to the gospel, to know the different breadth of Christian denominations that's out there, right? It has a very specific focus and it's designed to train ministers. And that's Faith Leaders, right? And that's what it is. And that's just what it is, right? So that's the second focus point. The third focus point is what I call faith communities. Faith communities are communities of believers in local cities around the world with the focus of studying the Word of God together, spending time together, and serving together, right? And so the church here in Atlanta is the first community of believers that I've started, and with the focus of serving together, studying together, and spending time together, right? These faith communities are not designed to be mega churches. They're designed to be small enough for everybody to be known, but large enough for impact in your community, right? And so the number of people that God's kind of placed my heart for that thing is about 120 people, kind of like the upper room, right? So about 120 people is about the right size for a faith community, and what he's placed in my heart. And so in the way he says, it's like about 60 adults and about 60 kids, right? So it's not like 120 adults, like about 60 adults and about 60 kids, right? Somewhere around there, plus or minus 10 people or so, right? So that's faith communities. Has a very specific function, a very specific goal. It still flows out of the theme of my calling of equipping people to do what God's called them to do, right? And so, but that's a separate thing than church or entrepreneurs, than faith leaders, but it has its own unique focus. And then the fourth thing that I just launched this quarter was Before and After the Wedding. So Before and After the Wedding is a YouTube channel. It's focused on helping single believers and married believers develop their future marriage or their current marriage, right? The reason why we're doing that is because there are people who are called to be married and a lot of marriages are floundering, right? And those who are called to be married, if your marriage is messed up, it's going to destroy your calling in the other areas of your life, right? And so that ministry or that focus is just focused on providing content around godly marriages, godly dating, right? It's focused on that particular type of content, right? And that's its focus, right, for that thing. So I literally got like four focus points. I got church entrepreneurs, got faith communities, we got faith leaders, and we got before and after the wedding, right? So what I have to do is be content disciplined in all four areas. And then I need to start to build the infrastructure to allow these things to function since I'm still just one person, right? And so, and knowing God, he probably got other things he wants me to create too, right? So it's probably not just these four, it might be another 10 things he wants me to create, right? But you only can create things as you have infrastructure to allow things to expand. And as long as the things are expanding, kind of coming out of kind of how God created me, how he called me to be, you know, they have that same tie in together, right? And all four things are still under the same CFE umbrella, just that they're called different things, right? They're still under the same church. One of the things I'm learning about thinking in this kind of multidimensional thought process is you got to be disciplined per thing, right? Each thing needs to have a very defined goal, a defined reason to exist. And you can't blend between things, right? You got to be very clear. Like, this is for this. This is for this. This is for this. This is for this. Because if it's not, you start getting confused. Like, what is this? This church entrepreneurs? This before and after wedding? This faith community? Like, you get confused, right? So you got to kind of be, each one has its own focal point, right? Now, with that said, each thing has its own focal point, right? So what that looks like now is that I am praying for infrastructure, right? Now, how do we build this? And all of this is pretty much funded by partners, right? So which means that I need to get more consistent on my messaging about partnership. Because as we get more and more partners who are financially sowing into CFE, it allows me to actually build infrastructure to serve people more in these four particular areas, right? And so I have to get more disciplined about talking about partnership, asking for partnership, speaking to people about partnership, and then showing people like how your partnership is allowing other people to be successful. And so what's interesting about this version of partnership, so when I first started Church for Entrepreneurs as a podcast, people were partnering because they themselves want to keep hearing the podcast, right? So now I'm asking for a different ask. I'm asking for people to partner so people maybe that's different than them can get something else they need, right? So maybe a single person who has no desire to get married, they're still partnering with me because they desire to marry their married friends to have before and after the wedding. Or maybe people who are in marriage, they have no desire to be an entrepreneur, but they're going to partner with me so the people who are entrepreneurs can get what they need to, right? So it's almost like as a body of people, I'm requesting people to partner with me, even if it's not in your own interest to receive some of the things that I'm doing, right? So it's like a different ask, right? It's like, hey, here's the vision. This vision serves this particular type of person, and I want you to partner with me in this area, right? Even if it's not for you. I'd like you to partner me in this area. So it's kind of a long intro for open forum, but I just kind of want to share, you know, it's kind of what God's placed in my heart so far. And it's still in flux. I mean, this whole year, we're not done with the year new yet. So we still got some months to go, just in the fourth quarter, right? I definitely feel like for me and for us that this year, we're gonna leave this year on fire. Cause like we've been through the fire, we've dismantled some things. And we're going to leave this year with such a clarity of focus, a clarity of what we're called to do, that 2024 is going to be off the chain, right? Because like this year, I feel like I've been taken apart. And as we start to put the pieces back together, it's going to put us in position for 2024 to be just crazy good, right? But we got to go through the new now to get to the next, right? So with that said, I'm trying to think anything else I need to share with you about this. Now, my online community, Amos Johnson Jr., it's just going to be called Amos Johnson Jr. So right there, you can get everything I just talked about and get all the content, all the ministries, partner, everything's going to be, that's going to be the central hub that controls all of this. And so what's going to be different, open forum is still happening, of course, but this recording is not going on the podcast. I got to be content disciplined, right? So this recording is going to be posted in the community, right? Not on the podcast. Right. So I got to be content disciplined there. So, all right, guys, Zoom lines are open. You can ask me questions about this. You can change the subject, whatever you guys want to talk about. All right, go ahead, Sandra. You want me first?
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead.
Okay. First of all, thank you for sharing this information. And I'm so happy that Church for Entrepreneurs is back and the daily podcast because to be honest, that's kind of how I started out with this community. And I, as an entrepreneur, that was just resonated with me because being an entrepreneur and all the conflicts that you hear about spiritual connections and being able to find out what God really wants you to do. Yeah. And there's always been, you know, like those two don't go together like that. This entrepreneurship is worldly, and then there's a spiritual connection that you're trying to get. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so so I'm so glad that that's come back. CFE is back. That's really exciting, at least for me anyway, because that was my reason for joining. And I kind of have a question, and maybe it's probably, I'm sure, been answered, but can you feel like more than one thing is what God is calling you to do? Because I have a new business that I'm working on, and I'm really feeling like Spirit has actually called me to start a podcast, which I have started, and for this business. And it just really, the whole business, I love it and it resonates with me, but I also have another business that I'm really feel like I have been called to do over the years. And having a new way of doing it now.
Yeah.
So I feel like I'm really, you know, feeling like I have two callings, and I'm just wondering, is that realistic?
Yeah, it depends, right? So like right now I'm doing four different things, but in 2014, I could not have, right? Okay. So if God told me in 2014, do Church Entrepreneurs, before after wedding, ministry school, and do a local church, right? I couldn't have done those four things in 2014, right? I personally didn't have the spiritual capacity to do that. So 9 years later, I have the spiritual capacity to literally think on these four different planes and keep them straight in my mind and actually
Okay.
deliver how I need to serve people in these different areas. But in 2014, I definitely could not have done this at all, right? So God would could be speaking to you about different things and different callings. And the only question is it for you to do them right now at the same time, right? Are you in the position to actually do two different things? Because remember, once you add something else, by definition, it takes from the other thing. It takes you out of the equation, right? So it doesn't get your full self anymore, right? And so for me, I have the spiritual capacity to actually think through and monitor all four things. However, I don't have the physical time to do them all well yet. So, which means I need to add infrastructure to actually fully embrace all that's supposed to look like. So, answer, short answer, yes, he can when you're ready. Right? A lot of times what God does, he gives us glimpses of the future, but it doesn't necessarily mean now. Right? Because there's still some other stuff God's placed in my heart that he wants me to do. Like he still wants me to build a K-12 school, right? That's I haven't told, I don't know, I told you all that, but I definitely want to build a school and not just any school. It's supposed to be a Christian school that almost anybody can afford. So I got to figure that out, right? So that's on my docket of thought processes. And he also got a college in mind for me. He wants me to create some kind of college thing, right? That's on the docket too, right? But I definitely can't do those two things right now. Right. You know, you see what I'm saying? So like I'm not at the capacity yet to even think through adding those two things on agenda, but he's given me glimpses of that. Right. And so one of the things I've done now that I turned 50 last week, and Stephanie just turned 57. Happy birthday, Stephanie. So for some reason I forget that she's like when I met Stephanie, I think she might have been barely 50. I don't even know. It's been so long now. Yeah. But anyway, we're getting older, all of us. So, but now that I'm getting older, I'm realizing that I need to take time off the table, right? Because I was always like, okay, by 50, I need to have this accomplished, or by 40, this needs to be done, or by 30, I need to be here. I think when you start thinking, you put an age on it limits what God can do, right? Because you put an age on it. Okay, by 60, I need to have this happen, and it may not happen. But if I think of time being more, because really right now, because we're believers, we're living in eternity right now anyway, right? We're already in eternity. We already have everlasting life right now, right? We just living in a physical body in this side of it, right? So we need to I need to break the concept of time and not worry. Okay, God, you may call me to do the college thing in my 70s, and that's okay, right? It doesn't have to all get done this decade. Right. It's almost like thinking with bigger time horizons, right? Like maybe in my 80s, I'll start something different. Right. That's okay. Right. Cause like I'm 50. I thought when I got 50, I'd be ready to slow this whole thing down. Right. Literally. Right. But I'm literally still ramping up. Right. It's like, man, I'm still ramping up. And I thought by 50, I'd be slowing it down. You know, so I'm thinking about time differently now. Right. So it's not like I got to rush and get it all done now. I have t more time to really think through these things and to develop these things. And who knows, maybe for 5 years, God may need me to go do some training for 5 years before I launch the next thing. You see what I'm saying? So I'm thinking like, that's okay. That's okay, right? That's okay. So good question, Sandra. Good question. Yeah.
Okay, thanks so much.
Yeah. Let's go to Celine next.
Yes, hello. Yes, I was just listening to you saying about the four areas and how you were saying that you now have clarity. And
Per area, yeah.
in the four areas, and you explain very articulately, okay, in this area, this is what I'm going to be doing here. In this area, this is what I'm going to be doing here. In this area is what I'm going to be doing here. In this area, and why, and how it all belongs together, even though it's, it's like it's in one plant pot. It's one plant, but it's got different
Yeah, that's a good way.
branches,
I like the analogy. Yeah.
right? And you're building the roots and the foundation within these branches, and the core branches is your focus in your relationship with God, is the strength and the roots, and he's kind of branching out these incredible things. And from under it, people will be blessed and be able to lean in that shade, you know, as time passes, as you build your business. And the thing that came to me to mind was energy and clarity. And I wanted to ask you, now that you're clear, now you have a clarity in those four areas, what does it feel like, even though you can't focus, deep.
Yeah.
But God has given you enough capacity to focus in each area to start building these things. What does that feel like on a daily basis when you're planning?
Okay.
You know, how do you feel energetically and mentally and emotionally when you're, you know, okay, I've got these four things and I have to be on point and I need to be able to, but I don't want to get drained or, you know, because an entrepreneur, we have all these hats and plates we're swinging. And I'd be interested to hear your take on that.
Yeah, good question, Celine. The first thing, what it did for me, I feel more clear now. Before this, I was confused, right? Because like, God, I got passion over here for this. I got passion over here for that. And I was trying to make it all fit into one soup, right? And it was tasting terrible, right? And so the clarity of separating out to separate dishes, like, oh, if I separate out to separate dishes, they all taste great separately. And then if you eat them together one at a time, like a regular meal, that's how it's supposed to work versus taking everything and squishing all together and stirring it up and putting it in one big bowl, right? And so now that they're separated to their own separate silos, it brings a level of clarity to my mind that's actually calmed me down a little bit because I'm clear. I mean, I had a time to do it all, but at least I'm clear now. Like, this is this. This is this. This is why we're doing that. It's very clear, right? And now the next thing it does, it forces me to structure my time more consistently, which means I can't just be messing around. Like, so like, for example, if I'm gonna do a daily podcast, I need to pick a day of the week where I just knock out seven in a row. You know what I'm saying? And then when I'm doing faith leaders, I got to pick a day of the week where I'm working with the faith leaders. Right. And then when I'm talking about marriage stuff, I need to pick a routine. So right now in the marriage stuff, the routine is every day I'm producing a reel for social media. Right. So that's the routine right now. Right. And then on Thursday, I have marriage conversations that I post on a YouTube channel. So that's the routine. Right. And so it's forcing me to have better routines and to be better focused with my time because now the time is more compact. It almost reminded me when I was in middle school. When I was in middle school and up to the eighth grade, I had terrible grades, right? I was doing no extracurricular activities. I was just a student and my grades wasn't really that good. However, in eighth grade, I started playing basketball. And then when I played basketball in eighth grade, that limited my time. I had practice every day and we had games on Saturday. So I had less time to study because I had more time, because I had to spend time doing basketball. And interesting enough, my grades got better, actually, right? My grades got better because I was more focused. Like, man, I only got an hour to study, so I can't be messing around now, right? Because I got to go to basketball practice. So the actually constraining of my time made me better student, actually. And so I think right now what I'm feeling is like by constraining my time with it has to do certain things at certain times, I think it's going to make me a better minister. That make me better focus when I am engaged in the thing, right? Versus just loosey goosey kind of, I just do stuff whenever type of thing. Like, no, I can't do that anymore. Like when it was just Church for Entrepreneurs, maybe, but now it's Church for Entrepreneurs. Now it's faith communities. Now it's before and after the wedding. Now we got faith leaders, right? I got to be way more disciplined, right? And if you think about people like a T.D. Jakes, Elon Musk, Zuckerberg, like they got to be very disciplined to actually do the things they do, right? So that's what it's done for me, Celine. It's making me more disciplined. Because I am very kind of go to flow kind of person, you know, and that can only take me so far, right? I like waking up whenever, and I'm gonna figure out what I'm gonna do today as I wake up, right? But to do this now, I need to be a little bit more disciplined and I definitely got to be content disciplined, right? So like, it's no more, I got to just drop stuff in the podcast. That I want to drop in the podcast. Like, no. Every day, got to be a podcast on this topic, you know, and then on the marriage stuff, like it's got to be on this topic. Don't deviate. I know I got all stuff I want to say. And so like my community is going to be like my catch-all when I want to say something that doesn't fit in the category. I'm gonna put it there, right? It's not, like everybody else like has a junk drawer and they just put stuff in where it goes. And so when I have stuff, I don't know where it goes. It'll be in the community somewhere. I don't know where this goes, but this is what I want to say right now. And so this is what I'm saying. And I'm even being content disciplined on my social profiles. So on my Amos Johnson Instagram profile, I am content disciplined just to put reels about marriage. And it'd be amazing how hard that is. Like, I got so much I want to talk about. And all I said, okay, nope, I can't put it on Instagram because I've got to be content disciplined here. Right. So, yeah, that's what happened with me, Celine. It's making me more disciplined just with that. So, good stuff. Good question. Let's go to Derek Taylor and then we go to Steph McNeil. But Derek.
How's everybody doing today?
What's going on, man?
You got it. And I want to give a shout out to Stephanie. Happy birthday, young lady. I think one thing, if I may, that we, I think, will benefit us greatly is if we understand, kind of look a little deeper into the feeling of things. When we speak about feeling, the peace of God, the love of God, and the joy of the Lord, which is our strength.
Mm-hmm.
We cannot depend on feelings for that, because none of that is predicated on feeling. In the middle of a storm, you can have the peace of God.
Yeah.
That's incredible. You can have everything going wrong with you, but you can have the joy of the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess and we all understand that love is a person, is something. It's not a feeling, because mm-hmm. if that were the case, whoa, that's scary to even think about that. But
yeah.
So I think a lot of pursuit and perseverance will be able to be more ahead if we didn't concentrate so much on feeling, because mm-hmm. when you concentrate on feeling, you're removing walk by faith and not by sight.
Because to do these things that God's placed in our hearts, we got to walk by faith, not by sight. Right. A lot of things that God's placed in our heart to do, it's not naturally to see how this can work. Right. And another thing I didn't mention to you guys, which helped me go through this. I've stopped asking my question, how does this make money? Right. That was helpful. You'd be amazed how helpful that is, because like when I launch things and like, I know I shouldn't, but in my back of my mind, like, okay, if I do this, how's this going to make money? How's it going to help my family? You know what I'm saying? Like, that's in the back of my mind. And that's actually pretty limiting, right? If I think about, I'm only doing things because I think it's going to generate some type of revenue, I'm missing it, right? And so this is the walking by faith thing. It's like you take money off the table. Like, God knows you need to eat and live and stuff like that, right? He knows that. But if your thoughts are dominated with how does something makes money, it's not going to be fully what it should be. Right. Because it's going to be limited by what money can do forward or through it. Right. So that's kind of was very, especially from a ministerial standpoint. This is just from a ministerial standpoint. Now, if you're a minister of the gospel, one thing I'd realize that there was no promise in the Bible that our ministry would 100% take care of our financial needs. Right. Jesus said we should be compensated from things we do, but it's not necessarily a guarantee that everything we do is going to take care of us financially, right? The Apostle Paul, he still had to make tents, even though he wrote 2/3 New Testament, he evangelized the entire known world, and that didn't generate enough revenue for him to live off of, right? So in ministers, I'm talking to ministers now, as ministers, you got to really take money off the table, and you really got to ask yourself, what did God call me to do? Who is he calling me to minister to, right? Because if you add that thought, well, how does that make money? Then he's going to just destroy what he makes want you to do, right? So that's one thing I want to just kind of share for ministers. Go ahead, Stephanie.
Oh, I just, everything you're saying today is just resonating with me, giving me all kinds of peace. The one thing I wanted to say that, several things, but Dr. Benjamin Hardy, again, he has a terminology for what you're talking about, how you have more productivity, more efficacy based on the fact that you have more things to do. There's a term for it, and I can't remember. I just heard it this morning. Can't remember. But he said when he was getting his PhD, the best thing that he did was adopted three foster children. That did everything to him and really catapulted him to his success that he has right now. But so what I wanted to know, because I'm kind of in the same space with, I know who I am, I know my identity, but I have these pieces out here. So what was your process like for getting to like, okay, these things, you know, are related, but they are separate things. How did you like,
how to process it?
And the other thing was, I did a similar thing. Like I had planned this event, a small intimate dinner in my home, because I just believe that the Lord gave me this home to help, you know, for people to come and heal and rest and all that. So, you know, again, the old Stephanie would have been looking at the numbers that RSVP, right? And and the old Stephanie would have canceled it. And I was like, nope, I don't care who shows up, who comes, who doesn't come. You know, I'm going to do it no matter what. And that's exactly what I did. Now, the backdrop of that was that, you know, my area of is always, you know, how am I going to make money from this, whatever. And ended up getting a revenue source of something that I totally had lost hope about. You know what I mean? So it's like, we can't really, we just really got to be open to God and to do what he's asking us to do, because we don't, we can't put a limit on how he blesses us, when he blesses us and all that, because it could definitely come from unexpected places.
Amen. Amen. So I think, you know, in the question, some of this is your answer, is that it's like, I'm doing this regardless of the physical look of it too. Right. And so for me, my process occurred, the really biggest thing that helped me was that I don't have to make each thing be related. Right. So before this, I was trying to put the name CFE on everything. Like, this is CFE Ministry School. This is CFE Atlanta. This is CFE Marriage Stuff. This is C, like, so like when I tried to put that name on everything, it just created confusion for me. So the stream focus point that each thing had its own reason to exist, and that's its reason to exist still flowed out of my purpose, my being. That was really what's really did it for me, right? Okay. Church for Entrepreneurs should exist as this. Church for Entrepreneurs is not that, and I don't need to make it that, right? And because I was trying to make everything that, right? So like I had this model was, okay, we started here, and then Church for Entrepreneurs needs to be able to be the umbrella for everything I want to do. Recipe for disaster, right? And so when it becomes the umbrella of everything I want to do, it gets confusing. Like, what really is Church for Entrepreneurs now? Like, it's not what it got called it to be in the early days. It's something totally different now that God never called it to be, probably, right? Because I was probably growing it too much. It's almost like you get a house, you keep putting stuff in it and in it and in it, and it gets kind of junky, right? And then you guys like, okay, let's declutter, let's separate some stuff out. This goes in this room, this goes in this room. Let's be clear about the purpose of this thing. Why does this thing exist? And when I asked the question, why did Church for Entrepreneurs exist? It was so that people can renew their mind the word of God, so they can hear God, so they can be successful in what they're called to do. That's why it existed, right? Now, if I just focus on why it existed and let that be its driving power engine, it keeps it clear. Like, why does this exist? And so for me, Stephanie, it's just like, just getting that clear was really the process. Like, oh, this exists for this. And then also, too, you got to separate the one-off assignments, too. You know, God could speak to your spirit to do something one time or two times. It doesn't mean he wants you to build another stream around it. It just do this for now. I want you to be a blessing here right now. That's it. Nothing bigger to it. Don't put any infrastructure around that. Just go do that. It's not designed to scale, right? I just need you to go be a blessing here and do that, right?
Well, so, how do you determine that? How do you determine it's a one-off or if it's, you know, something that should continue?
I assume it's a one-off when I first hear it. That's what I'm doing. Mm. I'm assuming it's a one-off until it shows it's not.
Oh, wow.
Right?
I love that.
So
okay.
Before
that makes
and
it
after,
real easy.
Yeah. So before and after the wedding, I assume it was just for this last quarter. That's my first. Okay. God, you're talking about marriage. I'm big on having successful marriages. Okay. I'm going to just do this for this last quarter. That's how I started this. And as I started doing it, I was like, you know what? I think this is bigger than just one quarter of the year. I think this should have its own life. Right. So I started with the assumption this is temporary. Right. And then as I started doing it, I was like, okay, no, this is not really temporary. So I think for me, I think it's helpful. Like, okay, God told me to do something that might be temporary. It will be temporary until he shows me it's not. So that's kind of how I process it. And because I have a platform to do temporary things like the My Networks platform, I could just spawn up an event or something temporary without a whole infrastructure. It doesn't need its own website. It doesn't need its own domain name. Right. It just need, let me go to the calendar. Hey, I'm doing this. Click here if you want to come to this. And if it keeps coming back over and over again, okay, God, is this another stream that needs to have its own infrastructure around it, its own focus point, right? That's how I process it, Stephanie. Good questions.
That's
cool. Yeah. It's assuming temporary up front, and then we'll see where it goes after that. So,
I'm sorry.
But now,
I just want to say, I think that content discipline that you brought up really helps out big time. That content discipline aspect that you brought up.
Yeah. I definitely, it's amazing how hard it is sometimes. Like, I'm being content disciplined about, like on Thursday when we're talking about marriage, Let's be content disciplined. This is what we're talking about today. We're not talking about business. You know, we're not talking about raising kids. We're talking about the relationship between husband and wife. Let's be content disciplined, right? What we're talking about. So let's go to Jalisha and then we go to Jessica.
Hello. Yes, I like content discipline as well. That was really wonderful. Okay. So how do you stay I don't know if your children are older, but
They're young, 14 and 10. They're 14 and 10. So
14 and 10. Did you start your ministry? Okay, because I have a newborn, new baby and 4-year-old. So how do you, and you probably, you and your wife probably work around, you know, sports, things like that, birthdays. How do you balance that with to stay consistent with family and ministry?
Yeah. The mistake I made, Jalisha, when I first started this in 2004, actually even before 2000, let's go back almost like 2008. Well, 2009, my 14-year-old was born. The mistake I made was that I was in a rush hurry to be successful, right? So it was almost like, okay, I'm doing this so my kids can have a future. My kids can have this, you know, I'll tell myself all the stories, right? I'm doing this for her, right? So she's a baby, I'm doing this for her. And so I realized as she got older that I hadn't spent enough time with her because I was always in the hustle and rush of trying to build ministry or trying to build something. Right. And it's like, I was missing her life because I was out doing stuff to try to make her life better. Right. and so I have a 10-year-old. And so with the 10-year-old, I made a drastic shift with her. It's like for my 14-year-old, when she was little, if I was on something like this, the Zoom call, like the door would be locked and she literally could not get in because I'm doing this. I'm locked in. Don't bother me. My 10-year-old has a 100% open door policy. She literally, if she was here, she could literally come in right now and ask me a question. I will stop what I'm doing here and I go talk to her. Right. Another thing I do is like, I don't hide the fact that I have kids. Right. When my little girl was younger, when I was on a business phone call, I was like, be quiet. I don't want anybody to know that you're here next to me. Right. You know, I'm just quote unquote professionalism. Right. And so now if I'm on a call and my kid starts talking or whatever, I'm like, hey, hold on. My little girl needs something. So I don't shy away from the fact that I've got other family responsibilities. And the next mindset shift is that actually spending time with the kids is actually more important than doing ministry. Right. So that's another mindset shift. So even if ministry, because ministry is going to be here for decades, my kids may only be with me for 18 years. Right. So they got a shorter time span, you know, before they are grown. Right. My 14-year-old is literally like be 4 years away from leaving the house. Right. Like that thought process just hit me like, man, I may have literally only 4 years left with her. Right. And so do I want to spend these next 4 years just in hustle mode and not seeing her, but 30 minutes a day? Or do I need to spend time with her? So when she's not here, you know, I felt like I've spent my time with her. So Jaleesha, I think just making the kids a priority, that they are more important than whatever else God's called me to do.
Thank you.
All right, so the camera froze again. All right, sorry about that, guys. All right, I'm back. Sorry about that. Can everybody hear me? Thumbs up.
Yes, sir.
All right, thank you, thank you. Yeah.
Yeah, and we heard everything, the end.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I guess I need to go buy another computer. That's probably the answer. You need another computer, Amos. So, but yeah, Jaleesha, does that make sense, Jaleesha, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, it makes sense. It's like, okay, and it resonated with me as well, because I was doing yoga, and I noticed when I first started doing yoga videos, like spiritual yoga videos, I did, you know, when my son would try to come in the video, I would like restart the whole video, and it would take me hours because I would try to be so perfectionist, personalist. And then I would have like 1, 2, 3, 4 videos in a long span of time. I wouldn't get anything done. Yeah. But then once I just start just letting them wander off, and then he'd wander off pretty quickly, really. Yeah. Then I start being more consistent with it. So I don't know why that resonated with me, because I'm like, I do the same thing right now, just reading the daily word as a ministry or whatever. But sometimes when my kid would come in or say babbling, then I would like try to restart the video, do the word over. And then that resonated with me with this. Kind of like the same thing with the yoga thing. It's like, just let them wander. I'm a parent. There's no need to like pretend I'm not a parent. Okay. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Good question. Good question. All right, Jessica, you're next. And then Ashley, you're going to wrap us up.
Hi. So my friend, she's starting a rehab center for recovering addicts, and she gave me the duty of ministering. And I have no clue how to start, what to do. I'm learning myself about the Bible, and it's been like really tough, like trying to get into the word. I have the kids, I have my grandkids, I'm doing this, I'm serving the church, and it's like, do I go to school for ministry, or would that be a waste of time, or just keep myself into the word and just study, like start from the beginning in Genesis and work my way through the Bible? Like, I just need guidance.
Okay. So let's talk about ministry first. Let's just wrap that up. So you probably do need some type of systematic study process for ministry. If you join our Faith Leaders program, it gives you a curriculum to go through. It'll take you through like different things. So it'll be more systematic. Right. But if you don't join Faith Leaders, you could probably find some other, just something that's curriculum based that'll kind of give you like, okay, today I'm doing this. Today I'm studying this. Today I'm learning about this. Today I'm learning about that. It'll help you be more consistent and be more focused than versus like, let me just read the Bible cover to cover, which you should. But if you want something a little more structured and focused, I would suggest finding a program that fits your schedule correctly, so you can be more focused and more structured in what you do. Now, biblically speaking, you know, God never said, oh, only people who go to ministry school can be ministers. He never said that scripturally. Ministry school is just a help to kind of train you in some of the basic doctrines, get you focused on your study, your teaching, that type of things. So your call to ministry exists whether or not you go to ministry school or not, right? You just call it a ministry. The only question is, what does God want you to do in terms of preparation so you can do the things that, you know, he's called you to do in the ministry space? And two, it sounds like you got a lot going on too in your life. So you want to just kind of look at what you have going on and ask yourself, how much time can I give to this particular area, this new assignment that is my friend is asking me to do, right? Because like, you don't want to commit to more than you actually can do, right? Mm-hmm. And so if you can say, you know what, I can commit to 2 hours a week ministering to these people, and that's all I got, right? So versus saying, hey, anytime you need me, you know, just call me. That may be too open. You're like, hey, on Thursday at 2 o'clock, I got an hour. And so well, we can get this done in an hour, and I can minister. Let's take the book of Matthew, and we're going to go through one chapter a week. You know what I'm saying? Like, be very structured like that. And I'm going to read this chapter to them, and I'm going to explain to them what it means. And then we're going to do this on a systematic basis. Right. Yep. So something like that to keep you focused. Or you can go into my online platform. You could just pick a message series. Say, hey, I'm going to do this message series on faith that Pastor Amos did already. And we're just going to go through each one of these for the next 5 weeks. So anything that's in my community, you can just take and use it. So there's no copyright there. You know, God told me there's no plagiarism in the kingdom. It's his stuff anyway. So so just take anything there and you use it, and then you just use that as your curriculum to teach stuff you want to. So
thank you so much.
All right. Thanks, Jessica. All right. Let's go to Ashley.
Hi, everyone. I appreciate you, Pastor Amos, because I feel like, I don't know, it's everything you say is just always so on point, and it just resonates with me. Just how you were talking about with parenting, and just like, don't shy away from it. And that's your first priority. I just really appreciate it. I just wanted to hand you a bit of flowers and just say thank you for being so consistent and like honest. And I think sometimes your answers really surprise me, and I'm glad, because it'd be what I need to hear and what I want to hear, but I just be assuming that it's going to be something else because of what all the other pastors have said or whatever. But yeah, I just wanted to say thank you. Like, this whole conversation has been really helpful and really on point with where I am in my life and in my business. And so it's just been confirmation that I am hearing God, that God is hearing me, and that it's going to be okay. So thank you.
All right, praise God. Thank you. And I received the compliment of flowers. Thank you, Ashley. Appreciate it. Yeah. All right, Derek. Ashley was going to wrap us up, but I let Derek drop us in the last word, and we'll pray.
Ahead, thank Derek. You. And this was just for Jessica. I felt the spirit just had me tell Jessica that you would do wonders starting with your own testimony. You have a powerful testimony that you can speak to for class after class after class after class, but your testimony will lead you so much into the scriptures, because it is what the Lord has done actually for you that has changed your life in a tremendous way, that has made you the person you are right now. So that's where, I mean, I'm just saying, that's not the end all be all, but well, yeah, probably it is. But your testimony of God's goodness and what he's done for you is going to just catapult that whole ministry thing of addictions and everything.
Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thanks, Derek. Yeah. So Jessica, Derek flows in the word of knowledge and word of wisdom sometimes. So when he's speaking, he's usually not speaking from his own emotions. He's tapping into the spirit of God to kind of share, you know, encouragement to people. So praise God. All righty. All right. With that said, guys, let's wrap up. So guys, if you guys want to partner with my ministry, I'm going to drop that in the chat. Just go to AmosJohnsonJr.com/partner. And as you said, as you guys partnered, it allows me to build an infrastructure, the time, the resources to just do these different things that God wants me to do in order to, you know, to be a blessing to you guys, to whatever area that that our ministry serves you guys in. So thank you for that. Jessica, Faith Leaders right now is not quite open, but let me give you the link anyway for it. And if you really think you want to jump into it, I can probably open it up just for you. So take a look at it. All right. With that said, let's pray. All right. Father God, in Jesus' name, just thank you for this time together with the CFE family here, Father. I ask that your anointing is upon everybody here. The visions, the callings that you give them, Father, that they have the content discipline, they have the consistency they need, Father, to focus in on the things you call them to do, Father. And they can just do this well in the context of their marriage, context of their families, and that nothing shall fall by the wayside. Whatever they need financially, Father, just open their eyes to understanding, Father. Show them if there's anything they need to do to participate in growing themselves financially, Father, or show them they need to wait on you to open a certain door for them, Father. Just give them an insight and revelation around those particular issues, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.